Hi guys, welcome back to my channel. As you can see by the title, this is a very emotional video. It's a video that I do want to make, but I know it's going to be hard to make. I wanted to get it out to you guys to hopefully help people that are going through the same thing. I was pregnant in May, and I'm going to kind of go over everything with you guys. I'm just going to back up because there's probably a lot of people who haven't watched me and want to know my story. I have a 3-year-old daughter. She's really almost 4. In October, she'll be 4. 2016 I had her. January 2019 I miscarried at 5 weeks pregnant. Basically, really, it was like I was like 2 weeks pregnant. I had no symptoms of pregnancy, but I had a positive test. That kind of sucked, obviously, because we were looking forward to that pass before I could even have an ultrasound. So I miscarried then. It was painful. I did have cramps, but it wasn't like painful, like childbirth painful. I miscarried so early. I would have just mistaken that as a period if I didn't know I had a positive test. Okay, with that being said, May 2020 happened. I got pregnant. I'm gonna talk about the weeks I've gotten pregnant. So from weeks 1 through 8, so I was 8 weeks pregnant when all this went down. Weeks 1 through 6, I had very sore breasts. I tested. I was positive, stark line positive, very, very positive. I took like 1 million tests. And I was positive. And I was like, oh, cool. Like, this is it. I feel pregnant, like I did with my daughter. My symptoms were I had very sore breasts, very, very dizzy. But that's what I get in pregnancy. I don't know if it's the hormone surges, but I always get dizzy. I was nauseous. So I was like, oh, okay, cool. Symptoms are happening. And then very bad anxiety. Like, to the point where I haven't had anxiety that bad in a long time. I had, like, hot sweats, like, it was not good. And also I've miscarried before, so I'm just thinking my brain goes a million miles a minute. Okay, so at 5 weeks 6 days I had an ultrasound because I was keeping in contact with my doctor, and I'm friends with the nurse, so she's like, okay, come on in, let's just like confirm it's not, you know, tubal or anything like that. So I came in, he did the ultrasound. It looked normal, meaning it was in the uterus, it was stuck there, and there was a sac. There was no heartbeat. He said, too early, come back in 2 weeks. Okay, so between week 6 to 7, my symptoms pretty much disappeared. One day I would have nausea, anxiety, but anxiety is nothing new to me, pregnant or not. So week 6 through 8, my boobs got less sore. And I didn't feel pregnant some days, but the next day I would feel pregnant and sick and just kind of want to stay in bed. At 8 weeks exactly, I went and got an ultrasound again. And as soon as he went in, I knew right away it didn't look right. Didn't look like my pregnancy with Liv. So what it was is it was a sac and it was in my uterus. It was like everything was looked fine, I guess, from the sac. But in the sac, it was just a circle, like, it didn't look right. So what he told me, he goes, this is not a normal pregnancy. You're going to miscarry within the next maybe 2 weeks. And if you don't, you will need a DNC. If you guys don't know what that means, they go in there and they suction out the tissue and whatever's in there. There was no baby in there. There was no sign of life or even life forming. So what kind of came to me is, because I kind of like blacked out because I was by myself. COVID. I was by myself, so I didn't really have the support of my husband, so I don't really remember what the doctor told me. From my understanding, the genetics didn't make it to the sac. So literally there was nothing in there. He scheduled a DNC for a week and a half later, and I was like, and then he gave me Percocets, or prescribed me Percocets, to just make sure that if I do pass it at home between then and the DNC, that I wouldn't be in a huge amount of pain. He did not want me to go to the hospital. He goes, if you start bleeding and are in extreme pain, you know that you're miscarrying, so just take the Percocets. So I said, okay. So I went home and my mom was home here watching Liv, and I just broke down. I didn't really know what to do. And then Chuck came home right away because, you know, hello, because he was working. So he came home right away and we talked about it. And I was like, oh, I just want to start bleeding now to get it over with. And then for some reason, I knew that my body was just wanting to hold on to this. So the next day, I was just having such bad anxiety, I texted the nurse, because we're like friends, and I said, get me in as soon as possible to get this DNC. Like, I want it over with. I just want it behind me. And I just hate the anticipation. I didn't want to pass at home. I didn't want to have a miscarriage at home, especially this late in the pregnancy, because it was quite, not large, but it was at the right gestation. So it was like 8 weeks pregnant, but with no child. Does that make sense? So it was larger than my 5 week passing that. So just kind of getting a gist of that. I didn't want to go through contractions. I saw horror stories online that it was like giving actual birth and you're just dizzy and you're vomiting and all this stuff. And I was like, I don't want to deal with that. So can you get me in as soon as possible for a DNC? And she's like, yeah, let me just call and see what happens. I got in for 2 days later. Let's backtrack. Because of COVID, I had to take a COVID test to make sure going into surgery, I didn't have COVID. So I went to the hospital, took a COVID test that day, the 2 days before, because they want to, you know, have a couple of days before, just make sure that you don't have COVID. And I took a COVID test. The test was not bad at all. She said it was a new test. It was basically just a cotton swab, and they just went up to here, and they went in there, and I was obviously negative for COVID. I mean, you never know, but I was negative for COVID. That Thursday, I went in and I got the DNC. And let me tell you, this whole COVID BS, you guys, if you're going through this right now during a pandemic, any kind of hospital stay, any kind of, I know when you give birth, you're allowed to be there or like have your husband or someone be there. But Chuck and I got to the hospital and I just absolutely lost it at the front door. Of course, they were doing COVID checks, all that. You have to wear your mask. So I got to the hospital, and because the night before the nurse called me and I was like, hey, you know, I'm not mentally stable. I don't understand medical terms, things like that. I kind of just, because I have a panic disorder. So I kind of just told the nurse like, hey, I need someone with me to understand what I'm actually going through and what I'm signing off on. Maybe that was a little push in the right direction of actually having Chuck with me, because they would not let him in. And when I got to the door, they would not let him in. And I literally fell to the ground just sobbing. I was like, can I talk to the lead nurse? Lead nurse comes down. She sees the state I'm in. She goes, okay, hold on for a second. She goes back inside. She talks to the surgical team or pre-op team or whatever, and they approve it. Thank God. So we go inside, okay, wearing masks, everything. Total procedure. For check-in, this is what is bullshit to me, but for check-in, I go into this room, which looks like a car salesman office, and guess what? It was. We sat down, we check in, and she goes, okay, wow, I can't believe they let him in. And I'm just like, bitch, just shut up and just sign me into the hospital so I can just get this over with. You know, don't give me attitude. I don't care. She was very, like, rude, and then she understood why I was there, and she kind of chilled out, and I was just bawling the whole time. And she goes, you know, it's $3,700 today. And I'm like, no, I didn't know that. I'm like, with insurance, because we have insurance. She goes, yeah, with insurance. How are you going to pay today? And I'm like, I'm not the kind of person that is just going to pay $3,700 up front. I just, you know, I'm not going to do it. And then I was like, okay, can I pay half or whatever? And Chuck goes, no, you're going to pay $100 towards it. And I'm like, okay. And she goes, yeah, you could do that. Anyways, so that's what we did. But I'm like, really? They make you do that right before you're freaking getting a miscarriage procedure? It's just, it's bullshit. They should have just gave me a bill like they did when I had Liv. The nice nurse met us there and she walked us back to the pre-op room, and we went over like allergies and stuff like that. Just typical procedure stuff. They made me wipe down my whole body with like these antiseptic wipes. It was like a big wet wipe basically. It got into my gown. They gave me Tylenol to pre-treat the procedure, I guess, just to kind of keep pain down for afterwards. My doctor came in. He talked to me. I love my doctor. He makes me feel at ease. He's like, oh, I'm sorry this happened to you. So then the anesthesiologist came in. He was super nice too. And I would say I was in maybe pre-op for like 15 minutes. And then Chuck was with me the whole time during this time. Of course, I had him with me because I feel like I wouldn't be able to do this without him. And then they wheeled me back to the surgery and they opened the doors. They said, Chuck, you gotta go, which was fine. They reeled me into the room. I was literally like meditating. When I'm that anxious and that scared, I shut down, I'm completely quiet. And so they were talking to me and I get up on the table. They wheeled me back there, but they told me to get up on the table because it's like ones with stirrups because he's got to get in there. So they wheeled me in the table. Anesthesiologist is like, what do you and your family like to do for fun? And I'm like, I don't know. He goes, you don't know? He goes, yeah, you guys probably have fun. And then the nurse puts the thing on my finger and she goes, oh, I like your nails. And then that's the last thing I remember. And then I wake up in the post-op room and I wake up shaking. I don't know if it was just anxiety. I think it was anxiety. When I woke up, she's like, you wanna get dressed? And I was like, yeah, hold on a minute. Cause I was shaking. I was like, can you guys give me Ativan? And mind you, I have not had Ativan in 5 years. It's like before I had Liv. But I was anxious because Chuck wasn't there. And I said, I'm just anxious because I don't have my husband. She goes, he's right outside. We already called him. He's outside for you. She goes, if I give you Ativan, you have to stay here for 30 minutes more. And I was like, no, I'll take it in the car, whatever. By the time she got me dressed really fast, where it felt fast, I was in recovery for like literally 10 minutes, it felt like. I'm sure it was longer, but I woke up and I was like literally gone. By that time, when I saw him, my anxiety kind of went away and I was more at ease that I got to go home. I wasn't in pain. I was like kind of really teary-eyed and just sad. And really that was the end of the surgery journey. I wanna let you guys know, even in post-op or post-op, I was wearing my mask when I woke up. Yes, it was kind of annoying, but I didn't even realize I was wearing it until I got in the car and I just took it off. It's different, especially going through a pandemic, going through this. I think God for that nurse that let Chuck in. And I'm sure it's hard going through pregnancy, especially your first pregnancy during a pandemic, because your husband's not allowed to go, or your partner's not allowed to go with you during these times to look at the ultrasound, look at the first heartbeat, things like that. I'm sure you can FaceTime, but it's not the same. Mentally, I'm okay. I do, like, I was crying all last night. So it just makes me sad because it just pushes it out further and further for Liv to have a sibling. A lot of my friends are pregnant right now. I'm so happy for them. I'm not mad. I'm not sad. I'm not anything. I'm very happy for them. I know it'll happen for me. It's just a matter of time. So the days following the surgery or after the surgery, I was in pain. I was taking 800 milligrams of Advil every 6 to 8 hours. 4th of July, so I had on the 2nd, and 4th of July I was out walking around and running after Liv. In conclusion of this whole miscarriage during the pandemic, I'm sad, don't get me wrong, but when I saw the ultrasound, I knew that it wasn't right. There's no child in there. There's no saving anything. So this is my second miscarriage, first DNC. Hoping it doesn't ever happen again. And also I had you guys that I've told I was pregnant. I've only told a select few of followers that were catching on, like, where are you? One of you guys on Instagram really helps me, so. Okay, not gonna cry. I'm gonna go into this right now. I feel like some of my followers are more passionate than my actual friends. And then if you're some of my real life friends that are watching this, it's probably not you anyway, but there's this, not meme, but thing that says, there's friends that, this is the friend that's listening, and then this is the friend that just wants to make you feel better. Like, oh, everything happens for a reason. The one that just wanted to make you feel better. And it's like, no, like, there's certain things you don't say to people. And I understand that there's things that you don't know what to say. And then you should say that instead. I'm so sorry, I don't know what to say. Instead of, things happen for a reason. It's in God's plan. You should do this, you should do that. Or why didn't this happen? Don't say that to people who are going through miscarriages, pregnancy loss, you know, anything, or even death with like a family member, things like that. Just listen, maybe give a relatable thing. If you can't relate, just say, I'm here to talk, than just trying to like suggest things. I know you want to make it feel better, but it doesn't feel better when you do that stuff. So, and it's like they only checked in on me once, and it's like days later and they haven't texted me. Couple friends, some of my friends don't even know. I didn't even cry till the end, you guys. But there is my story. I hope you guys got something. If you have any questions, and if I left anything out, I'll leave them down in the comments. I'm gonna start my channel over. It's gonna be like mommy channel, things like that. I'm gonna do cooking videos, mommy videos, all that. I just wanna kind of get my life going, get my routine back, and get back to talking to you guys, because you are what makes me motivated and, okay, don't cry, give me a purpose, because this is what I love doing. And yeah, so I love you guys and I will talk to you guys later.